So the today's topic is preservation, and in preservation we have to study about the thermal methods generally used for preservation purposes. So physical method, thermal processing will be covered in today's lecture. So preservation is a method of giving some additional treatment to different food items to stop or slow down the food spoilages. And why you people have to do this preservation in different food item? For restricting spoilages, for maintaining quality, edibility, edibility, nutritional values, and improving shelf life of product. So preservation usually restricts the growth of bacteria and fungi responsible for creating various kind of deterioration problems in food. And as all of you know, humans have used methods of preserving food just for making it suitable for a longer period. You can eat it after a certain gap, especially which season is in season when it is not available naturally. So at that time you can use these preserved food. So preservation of food prevents the food from being spoiled by the action of enzyme and microorganisms. What is happening in preservation? We are mainly attacking on the micro present in your food item. At the same time, you have to inactivate the enzymes present in your food. So the preservation of food increases the safe storage period of food stuffs. And it also increases the availability of out of season foods. I have already told you, in case of fruits and vegetables, some foods are naturally present available in summer season. So just by giving some kind of preservation technique, you can preserve it and you can utilize that kind of food in winter season. It increases the availability of various foodstuffs when at distance and not easily approachable places. You see, some of the green vegetables are produced in Ranchi and they're directly transported to our place and we use it in off season. Now, what are the method of preservation? In that case, it is categorized in two parts. One is traditional method and second one is modern industrial methods which people are using nowadays. So drying, cooling, freezing, boiling, heating, salting, sugaring, smoking, pickling, canning, and burial, these are the things which are generally used traditionally. So what we are doing, just by keeping below earth, sometimes you are digging a hole and you simply keep your food item inside that dig and covered by the soil, and after a certain period of time you are taking it out and then you start using that food item. So these are the methods of these are the traditional methods, and the next one is industrial modern methods. Pasteurization, you all have idea about this. Then vacuum packing, artificial food additives, addition of artificial food additives having some kind of microbiological antimicrobial effect on food items. Then irradiation, pulse electric field, electroporation, then modified atmosphere, packing under modified atmosphere, non-thermal plasma methods are also used, then high pressure food preservation, biopreservation, and huddle technology. So you have to remember the name of all these modern techniques which people are now which people are using for preservation purposes. Now here some are the thermal method, because we are mainly concerned with the thermal method. So ohmic heating, microwave heating, radio frequency heating, infrared heating, and inductive heating are thermal methods, and high pressure processing, pulse electric field, ultrasound, high intensity light, then pulse X-ray, gamma radiation, modified atmosphere packaging, and membrane technology. These are the non-thermal methods generally used in our industry, different industry. So first of all, something about drying process, which is one of the oldest method of food preservation. What is happening in this drying, or you can say dehydration method? So it is a process of removing water or moisture from a food product. And removing moisture in dehydrated foods are ideal for packing, transportation, and storage because they weigh much less than their non-dried form. Automatically, you are reducing the overall moisture content of that food item, and you can transport just by reducing the volume of that particular food item. You are in a position to transport it from one place to another place. And at the same time, this kind of food do not require refrigeration to maintain refrigeration condition for storing purposes. So drying food is also a way of preserving seasonal food for later use. So how this dehydration process preserve different kind of food items? What is happening in that? Food can be, as all of you know, that food can be spoiled by different kind of microorganisms, which either present in your food item or contaminated through air or some other means. So it have some enzyme in it, and just by the those enzymatic reaction, some kind of a spoilages problem may be observed in that particular food. So bacteria, yeast, and mold require sufficient amount of moisture in food for their growth, and thus causing a spoilage problem. So just by reducing the moisture content of food, restrict the growth of spoilage causing microorganisms, and slow down enzymatic reactions within the food. And the combined effect of this helps to prevent spoilage in dried food. You can see sun drying of different grain just after harvesting in villages, pickles generally dried in open air, open sunlight. So these things are traditional method which people are using for preservation purposes. Now the dehydration or sun drying is one of the most important method because of the following points: not required electricity, there is no electricity requirement in this kind of method, then it is less time consuming, it makes winter meal easier, it also requires less storage space, it is easy to handle. So because of these things, it is preferred over other traditional methods. Now after improvement of solar system, some one important methods have been developed, and that is called solar drying method. What is happening in that? It is differentiated from sun drying by the use of instruments or equipment to collect the sun's radiation in order to use radiative energy for drying application. And next one is the use of solar dryer traps the freely available sun energy, ensuring good product quality. So whatever sun rays or sunlight is available, that is trapped by some kind of instrument, and ultimately by the radiation, it is preserved for keeping those products for a longer period. Now, what is generally happening? What is our technological outlook? Heat, steam, radiation, chemical filtration, and so many other methods are generally used for food preservation system. And heating is most important method widely used in our industry, or especially you can say in food industry. Now the thermal preservation and processing of food. it refers control processes that are performed commercially. What is happening in dairy industry? We are giving so many different type of heat treatment during manufacturing of different dairy products. So in food, generally what is happening? Blanching, pasteurization, and commercially sterilization process. So these things are very important and generally used in different food industry. So increasing, in some cases, we can increase the severity of process to see the nature of that particular food item. Then inactive disease, it is used for inactivating diseases and spoilers causing microorganisms. And it also inactivates enzymes in food that can cause spoilages. So these are the main things that you have studied about all these things in previous classes. How you can restrict the entry, how you can inhibit a particular type of microorganism in a particular type of food item. So now something about blanching process, generally used for vegetable and fruits. The factors which influence blanching time are type of fruit or vegetable, then size of pieces of food, then blanching temperature and method of heating. So what kind of heating method we are generally using in blanching purpose? Hot water and steam blancher. So here in photograph you can see the instruments generally used for these two processes. So blanching is a process used prior to freezing, canning or drying, in which fruits or vegetables are heated for inactivating natural endogenous enzymes, for improving texture, for maintaining color, flavor, nutritional values, and removing entrapped air. So these things are our main aim. How we can inactivate the natural enzymes, how we can improve the texture, color, flavor, nutritional value of our product. So for that, we have to use these two different methods. And the method, selection of method is completely depend upon the nature and type of fruit or vegetable. So blanching serves a variety of functions. The main function is to destroy enzymatic activity in vegetables and some fruits before main thermal processing. So just to make it stable, your product stable, you have to give this kind of pre-treatment to your fruit and vegetable. And peroxidase and catalase, you have to remember the name of these two particular enzymes, peroxidase and catalase. These are the most heat resistant enzyme, and the activity of these enzymes indicate the effectiveness of blanching treatment. So whatever treatment of blanching you are giving, that should inhibit or destroy or inactivate these two particular enzymes because they are the most heat resistant. So automatically you have to remember the name of these two enzymes. So it is not a method of preservation, but it is a pre-treatment normally given in between the preparation of the raw material and processing treatment, which you have to use for further processing, that is sterilization, dehydration, or freezing purposes. Freezing. So blanching is also combined with peeling or cleaning of food to achieve saving in energy, space requirement, and equipment cost. So for these things, this blanching process is recommended. Now the most important for you people is pasteurization. You have already studied a lot about this, that what are the different type of time temperature combination people are using, LT, LT, then HT, ST. Then sometimes, depending upon the nature of food item, you have to increase the temperature, and automatically reduction of time is there. So these combination you have to remember and you have to keep in your mind. Generally two methods are used, and what is our main aim? Our main aim is to destroy all sort of pathogenic microorganisms present in milk, that is Mycobacterium tuberculosis and Coxsackie Barnetti. And generally we are using batch method as well as continuous method, and continuous method in which you are using this HTST, that is 72 degrees centigrade for 15 seconds. And in batch method, people prefer to use this 63 degrees centigrade for 30 minutes. So these two practices are generally done in our dairy industry. So what is happening in that? What type of microorganisms will survive in this? So the milk pasteurization temperature is sufficient to destroy all yeast, molds, gram-negative bacteria, and many gram-positive. And two groups that generally survive in pasteurization time temperature treatment, that is thermoduric and thermophiles. What do we mean by thermoduric? That can survive pasteurization temperature but can't grow at that level. And what is thermophiles? That is heat loving, or they can grow at that temperature level, and even they can survive, not only survive, but they can grow at that particular temperature range. So genera, Streptococcus and Lactococcus are thermoduric in nature, and Bacillus and Clostridium are thermophiles. So you have to remember the name of these microorganisms. So which microorganisms you have to consider for selecting different time temperature combination? What are the different type of microorganisms which will survive pasteurization temperature or which will grow at that temperature? Now the sterilization. Sterilization is a process of heating food at 121 degrees centigrade for varying times under pressure to ensure destruction of all viable microorganisms. All of you know that all sort of living cells will be destroyed if you give this sterilization treatment to your product. So thus resulting in improving shelf life of food items more than 2 years. And how you can know that your food item is completely sterilized? So just by appropriate plating or enumerating technique method, you can have idea about the sterilization effect. Some other methods are also there, but microbiologically you can have idea about performing these two tests. Food having a pH more than 4.6, such as meat and most vegetable, it must undergo severe heating condition to destroy all pathogens. Severe condition are applied primarily to ensure that Clostridium botulinum spores are destroyed during processing. So what is happening in canned food? You have already studied. They are the most problematic microorganisms in canned product. And canned food are called commercially sterilized, as no viable organisms can be detected by the usual cultural method. Now, dried microbial cells placed in a test tube and then heated in water bath are considerably more heat resistant than moist cell of the same time, because it is well established that protein denaturation occurs at a faster rate when heated in water than in air. So we have studied about the different factors. Automatically, if you are applying moist heat, it will be more effective compared to dry heat. Autoclave sterilization, you are using different kind of autoclaving system, pressure cooker type, horizontal autoclaving, then vertical autoclaving. It is there in our laboratory. So you have idea about this. There are different kind of fittings in that. Pressure gauge system is there. Then a valve is there for releasing steam, and pressure gauge is there. So just by using this, you are using it for sterilization purposes of different media, chemicals, or different items used in microbiological testing. So what is advantage of this autoclaving sterilization? Destroys microorganisms more efficiently than dry heat, and therefore a shorter exposure at a lower temperature is required in this case. Porous material can be sterilized without damage. An equipment or component of rubber and certain plastics such as nylon and PVC can also be sterilized by using this method. Then this ultra high temperature processing treatment, what is happening in this? We are selecting a very good quality of milk, and we are applying a very high temperature, that is 135 degrees centigrade or more for a fraction of second, depending upon the type and quality of your food item and what type of condition maintained during the collection and transportation and the expected bacterial load of that particular milk. You have to decide at a typical type of time temperature combination, and whatever temperature you are temperature treatment you are giving to your product, that should be followed by aseptic packaging. And you can use this type of treatment in fruit juices, cream, soya milk, yogurt, wine, soup and honey. So just by using this kind of treatment, you can maintain a very good quality. You can produce a very good quality of product. Nowadays, people have started using microwave system for sterilization purposes. So what microwave means, very short wave, which is shortest wavelength region of the radio spectrum and a part of the electromagnetic spectrum. You have to remember this line. Microwave is an electromagnetic radiation of shorter wavelength. Then it can reflect by conducting surfaces, just like optical waves. Since they travel in a straight line, then microwave currents flow through a thin outer layer of an ordinary cable. So you please remember these three, that how you can get preservation effect by using microwave. So what is happening in that this method? Microwave sterilization of food is a thermal process and performed by passing non-ionizing microwave radiation, usually at a frequency of 2.125 gigahertz to, and you have to maintain a wavelength of 12.21 centimeter through the food. And microwave radiation frequency used in food industry is in between common radio and infrared frequency. So you have to remember this particular line. Microwave radiation frequency used in food industry is in between common radio and infrared frequencies. So microwave heating takes place due to the polarization effect of electromagnetic radiation at frequencies between 300 megahertz and 300 gigahertz. It delivers energy to the food package under pressure and controlled temperature to achieve inactivation of bacteria, which is harmful for human being, and also enhancing shelf life of that particular food item. So in last slide, I have tried to give you definition of these five things, which are very important as the time temperature combination required for destruction of different kind of microbes or different level of load of microorganisms. So first one is thermal dead time. This thermal dead time is the time necessary to kill a given number of microorganisms at a specified temperature. And by this method, the temperature is kept constant and the time necessary to kill all cells is determined. So it is called thermal dead time. You have to remember the definition of all these three, all these five. Then thermal dead point. Thermal dead point is the temperature necessary to kill a given number of microorganisms in a fixed time, usually 10 minutes. So here, what is important in this thermal dead point? The temperature necessary to kill a given number. Suppose a population of 10 to the power 5 is there, or you have to see the temperature required to kill that number of microbes in 10 minutes. And you have to, just by having this thermal death point knowledge, you can say that how much lethality is required, how much severity of treatment is required for giving any sort of processing treatment. So now the third one is decimal reduction time or D value. Time required to kill 90% of the microorganisms or spores in a sample at a specified temperature. And the time required in a process to drop population by one log cycle. However, such a destruction is logarithmic, not possible to completely destroy microbe in a sample. So only a logarithmic reduction you have to note down. So now the next one is Z value, the increase in temperature required to reduce D to 1/10 of its value or to reduce it by one log cycle. That is called Z value. And the next one is F value, that is the time in a minute at a specific temperature needed to kill a population of cell or spores, and that is usually 121 degree centigrade. You people have already studied about this in first semester or in microbiology of fluid milk course. So this is all about the different kind of thermal treatment we are giving to our product just to improve the shelf life of those items. So this is all about the preservation technique, first preservation technique, that is thermal processing, and it is generally used in different dairy industry. So in the next class, we will study about some of the non-thermal techniques. So thank you. Thanks a lot.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir.